Apostolico sacerdotes famulum tuum Ionatan, sacerdotali fecisti dignitate vigere, presta quesum, sude iorum quoque perpetuo aggregetur consortio, per Dominum nostrum Iesum Christum filium tuum, qui tecum vivit et regnat in unitate Spiritus Sancti Deus, per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Lectio epistolae beati Pauli apostoli ad Corinthiam. Fratres et ecce mysterium vobis dico. Omnes quidam resurgemus et non omnes imputabimur. In memento dictu oculi, in novissima tuba, Canet enim tuba in mortuus sorgit corrupti, et nos mutabimur, uportet enim corruptibile hoc indure in corruptionem, et mortale hoc indure in mortalitatem, uva alter mortale hoc indure in mortalitatem, cum fiat servum scriptus est, absorpte est mors in corium, ubi est mors in gloria tua, ubi est mors in ludus tuum. Stimulus out of mortis peccatum est, virtus vero peccatum est, Deo laudat gratia. Quid erit nobis in cor, et Dominum nostrum Iesum Christum.
Thank you. solvere cum in favilla, et spere gavit cum sibilla, quantus tremor est fortus, quando iudet ex est venturus, puncta astrique discus solus, turba mirus pagens solum, et sepulcra regionum, cogere Domine sancte tronum, most obedit et natura, cum resurgit creatura, judicanti responsura, liber scriptus profer etu, in voto tum continetu, undem unus judice tu, iude ex ego opus et erebit, quid quid natet apparebit, nili nuntum remanebit, quid sum mise tuctic turus, quem patronum rogaturus, cum vixius tuus sit securus, rex fermente maes gratis, qui salvamus salvas gratis, salvam me fons pietatis, recordare Iesu die, quod sum causa tue vira, ne me pedas ira die, quaerens mese diis filasus, redemisti crucem passus, tantus labor consit casus, iuste ut ex sunt sionis, donum facrem missionis, ante diem rationis, ingemis quotam quam reus, culpa rubet vultus meus, supplicanti pace Deus, qui Mariam absolvisti, et latronem exaudisti, mihi quoque espem pedisti, preces mea non sunt digne, sed tu bonus ad benigne, ne perere me ne cremeri, inter oves locum presta, et abelis me sequestra, statuens in parte dextra, confutatis maledictis, flammis sacribus edictis, hoca mecum benedictis, orbo supplexe et acrinis, quod contritum quasi cinis, gere curam mei finis, lacrimosa die sima, qua resurgete ex pavina, judicamus honore mus, ui pergo pace Deus. Pie Iesu Domine, dona eis requiem.
Spiritu tuo,
come sei sempre, e sei tuo,
Dolinus obisum,
et spiritum,
oremus.
Domine Jesu Christe,
suscita nel sacrificio della nostra Chiesa, all'arma e gloria in nome suo, a tutti i tanti popoli nostri, per le sue ecclesie e sue sede.
Per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Dominus vobiscum.
Et cum spiritu tuo.
Sursum corda.
Ademus ad hominum.
Gratias agamus, Domino Deo nostro.
Dignum et exsum est.
Vere dignum et justum est, equum et salutare, nos tibi semper et ubique gratias agere, Domine Sancte Pater omnipotens et bene Deus, per Christum Dominum nostrum, in quo nobis spes beate resurrectionis effusit, ut quos contrista certum moriendi conditio, eostem consoletur, futuri immortalitatis promissio. Tuis enim fidelibus Domine vita mutatur non tollitur, et dissoluta terrestris huissimo incolatus domo, Aeterna in caelis habitatio comparatur. Et ideo cum angelis et archangelis, cum tronis et dominationibus, cumque omni militia celestis exercitus, hymnum gloriae tuae canimus, sine fine dicente.
Sanctus, Sanctus, Sanctus Dominus Deus Sanctorum, lege sum celi et terra gloria tua, Hosanna in excelsis, benedictus qui venit in nomine Domini, Hosanna in excelsis.
Mm-hmm. nobis coque peccatoribus. Per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Oremus, precepti salutaribus moniti, et divina institutione formati, audemus dicere. Pater noster qui es in caelis, sanctificetur nomen tuum, adveniat regnum tuum, fiat voluntas tua, sicut in cielo et in terra. Panem nostrum quotidianum, da nobis hodie, et dimite nobis debita nostra, sicut et nos dimitimus debitoribus nostris, et ne nos inducas in tentationem. Per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Pax Domini sit semper vobiscum.
Et cum spiritu tuo.
Agnus Dei, qui tollis peccata mundi, dona eis fecum. Agnus Dei, qui tollis peccata mundi, dona eis requiem. Agnus Dei, qui tollis peccata mundi, dona eis requiem.
Agnus Dei, qui tollis peccata mundi, dona eis requiem. Agnus Dei, qui tollis peccata mundi, dona eis requiem.
Domine non sum dignus. Domine non sum dignus.
ecce anuste, ecce titulit peccata morte.
Domine non sum dignus in trepsi secundae, satanum vi plero vot sin apaturum mei. Domine non sum dignus in trepsi secundae, satanum vi plero vot sin apaturum mei. Domine non sum dignus in trepsi secundae, satanum vi plero vot sin apaturum mei.
Lux aeterna luceat eis Domine, cum sanctis tuis in aeternum, quia pius es, requiem aeternum dona eis Domine, et lux perpetua luceat eis, cum sanctis tuis in aeternum, quia pius es.
Dominus tobiscum,
et cum spiritu.
Prosit quesumus Domine anime famili tui onatan sacerdotis, misericordiae tuae implorata clemencia, ud eius in quo speravit et credidit aeternum capiat, te miserante consortium, per Dominum nostrum Iesum Christum filium tuum, qui tecum vivit et regnat in unitate Spiritus Sancti Deus, per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Dominus vobiscum,
et cum spiritu tuo,
acquiescant in pace.
Amen.
That's the term we use for the head of our house, not general but provincial. The father told me, say the mass, but don't preach. Let the parish priest do that. And I was grateful, for his advice. I would have broken down. But for the father's funeral, it was his wish that I should preach. So if I break down, it's not my fault. Blame him. The father also said that he did not want a eulogy. I could always get a laugh out of him by reminding him of an acquaintance who pronounced it eulogy. So if this sounds like a eulogy, I hope the father will forgive me and maybe smile. What I will try to do, what I want to do, is to show the importance of St. Philip and the Oratory to the father, the importance of the Mass and the sacraments, the importance of obedience and prayer that animated the father and made this community, the Toronto Oratory, possible. The father loved St. Philip. He came to know St. Philip through Cardinal Newman, St. John Henry Newman. The father had come to know the Birmingham, that's the way they say it over there, and the London Oratory while studying for the priesthood in Rome. He almost joined the Birmingham Oratory, Newman's house. The Toronto Oratory began as a prayer group in Montreal in 1973. At one point, one of the members or participants, it was that earliest stage, began talking about our becoming a community, a commune, really. It was the 70s. It would all be very informal, ad hoc, and loose. And the father wasn't having anything to do with that. I can remember the evening when the father simply told us that it was an oratory, the oratory of St. Philip Neri that he wished to found. And if we didn't want that, then we could all leave. I could have. Thank God. Thank St. Philip. I didn't. Now, it wasn't about the father's way or nothing. It was St. Philip's way or nothing. God or nothing, as St. John of the Cross put it. Cardinal Newman wrote, "I can say for certain that whether or not I can do anything at all in St. Philip's way, at least I can do nothing in any other." That was the father's self-knowledge as well. He didn't want to invent something or promote his own way. He wanted to plug into a Catholic tradition, the communion of saints, the community founded by the second apostle of Rome, or third, if you count St. Paul. And in our early days, before we were canonically erected by the Holy See as an oratory, the father made a heroic, sacrificial choice. Remember, he was the chairman of the philosophy department at McGill, and to put it bluntly, he was our only source of income. I remember when an associate member of our fledgling house caused an unnecessary expense. "Oh, the housey will pay for it," was his remark. I could always get the father to flare up a little by quoting this and reminding him of this. So the father made the right choice and gave up McGill. Thank God again. Like St. Philip, the father loved the Mass. In his account of his conversion, the beginning of which he really attributed to his father's sudden death in 1948, he said that after that he began to go to the Catholic Cathedral in Montreal. Why that should have been the case is difficult to say. It had something to do with the fact that I detected a quiet note of assurance and authenticity that showed itself in worship that was clearly directed towards God, a God who was clearly taken to be a reality. There was, he wrote, "in those days at any rate, no hint that the real center of interest was the edification of the faithful. Mass was about Emmanuel, God with us. I recall thinking at Mass that this is where I belong. St. Philip is quoted as saying, "He who loves the Mass is already in paradise." I guess that means that all of us get a glimpse of paradise at Mass when we enter into it with reverence and awe. But I think it could also be said that the Mass is a means to paradise. And it's clear that Father Robinson, the Father, as a good son of St. Philip, truly loved the Mass. Along with the Mass, St. Philip emphasized obedience. And so I want to give you some of St. Philip's maxims. Obedience is a shortcut to perfection. There is nothing which gives greater security to our actions or more effectually cuts the snares the devil lays for us than to follow another person's will rather than our own in doing good. The good works which we do of our own will are not so meritorious as those that are done under obedience. Obedience is the true holocaust which we sacrifice to God on the altar of our hearts. In order to be really obedient, it is not enough to do what obedience commands. We must do it without reasoning upon it and hold for certain that what obedience commands is the best and most perfect thing possible, whether it appears so or not. Obedience means obeying not just our superiors, but our inferiors. The Father practiced obedience years ago, still in Montreal, long before Summum Pontificorum made the extraordinary form of the Mass possible, a form of worship that is clearly directed towards God, with no hint that the real center of interest is the edification of the faithful. He was going to start celebrating it, until someone told him that he shouldn't, and he obeyed. I won't say who told him. I will just say that I am definitely his inferior. St. Philip, too, practiced what he preached about obedience. Perhaps his greatest ministry was hearing confessions, apart from the Mass. In his declining years, when his community suggested that he shouldn't fatigue himself so much with hearing confessions, he cheerfully said that it wasn't fatigue, it was a recreation. And earlier, because he had been bad-mouthed to the Pope, perhaps out of jealousy because of his growing popularity in Rome, he was forbidden to hear confessions. And his response? "I began this work for the glory of God. For the glory of God, I will cease." He stopped doing a good work because, as he would also say, it's not enough to see whether God wishes the good we aim at, but whether he wishes it through our instrumentality, in such a manner and at such a time, and we come to discern all this by true obedience. When the fledgling Montreal Oratory began, with three of us living in a rented house, with the Archbishop's permission for the experiment, the Father laid down three simple rules: a half hour of prayer together every day, our evening community meal, and regular confession to a regular spiritual director. And it didn't have to be him. He was trying to be faithful to a tradition, a way of life that went back to St. Philip. So here are some things St. Philip says about confession, not only for his sons, but for people living in the world. "Frequent confession is the cause of great good to the soul, because it purifies it, heals it, and confirms it in the service of God. We ought not, therefore, to omit confession on our fixed days for any business whatsoever, but go to confession first and to business afterwards, and the first will help the second." When we go to confession, we ought to persuade ourselves to find Jesus Christ in the person of our confessor. And especially for Oratorian confessors, confessors should not be too strict while hearing confessions, nor should they frighten their penitents. Rather, they should be compassionate and seek to win them with love and kindness. That was the Father in going to confession and in hearing confessions. In the past several years, with his declining strength, the Father did not celebrate public masses frequently, only on special days, St. Philip's Day, our anniversary, Easter, Christmas, and then only the solemn high mass. But every and daily, it goes without saying, but every Sunday, without fail, he was in the confessional for the 15 minutes allotted before the high mass, and in fact, he had to start a half hour early, and often was in the confessional for 15 or 20 minutes into the mass. So, to prevent this from turning into a eulogy, I ask all of you to consider paying tribute to the Father by going to confession frequently and regularly. Love of the Mass, the importance of confession, prayer, humility, and obedience. The Father learned these, practiced these, and taught these, and not just for sons of St. Philip. St. Philip believed that lay people are called to be saints, saints in their own homes, and he worked tirelessly for that. The religious state, St. Philip said, is indeed the highest, but it's not suitable for all. Let persons in the world sanctify themselves in their own houses, for neither government position, professions, nor labor is any hindrance to the service of God. Our enemy, the devil, who fights with us in order to vanquish us, seeks to disunite us in our houses and to breed quarrels, dislikes, contests, and rivalries, because while we are fighting with each other, he comes and conquers us and makes us more securely his own. This last maxim applies to all of us, St. Philip's and the Father's sons, but it applies to all the Catholic faithful equally. The divisions in the church, the divisions in our families, the divisions most visible these days in our society, may well stem from honestly perceived injustices or wrongs, but are our techniques, our protests, our criticisms, our quarrels, our cooperation with evil, our rivalries and dislikes, are they helping Christ or the devil? Because while we are fighting with each other, he comes and conquers us and makes us more securely his own. As most of you will know, the Father had not a serious, but a fall, a small fall on St. Philip's Day, and so we brought him to the hospital. The next day, the gerontologist telephoned to get some background information on him about his lack of appetite, his almost continuous sleepiness and fatigue, his forgetfulness. She used the D word, dementia. I wasn't quite ready to go there. I wasn't that negative. I liken his condition to your cell phones. Your cell phone can be the most advanced, top quality cell phone in the world. But if the battery is dead, it's not going to work very well. And in a way, his death at home, in his own room, was a remedy to that dead battery. We believe that death is a punishment for sin, the original sin of Adam. And so it is. But death is also a remedy for sin. It's a remedy for cancer, for dementia, for diabetes, for heart disease. Would you like to live forever with a decaying, or decrepit, non-functioning body? Would you like to live with your sins on your soul forever? And so death is a remedy for sin as well as a punishment for sin. Saint Gregory of Nazianzus put it this way, not his exact words. Suppose you had a magnificent, elegant ceramic vase, and an enemy had treacherously filled it with a substance that had hardened, making that beautiful vase no longer functional or good for anything. The only way to free the vase from the substance is to smash it to bits. Some remedy. But what if God could take all those fragments and remake them into that magnificent, elegant vase again, with no chips, no traces of the hardened substance that had ruined it? And that's what the resurrection will do for us and for the Father. Death is an enemy, the last enemy to be overcome. But overcome it has been through the death and resurrection of the Son of God. So listen again to what St. Paul was saying in the first reading. Lo, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall be changed in the twinkling of an eye at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. For this perishable nature must put on the imperishable, and this mortal nature must put on immortality. When the perishable puts on the imperishable, and the mortal puts on immortality, then shall come to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy victory? O death, where is thy sting? Thanks be to God, who gives us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Sometimes, when the Father had to do something difficult in the community or for the community, and when he was fearful or worried about doing it the right way versus the wrong way, I would say to him, I just want you to know, and I'd pause. And he would sigh and say, yes, yes, that we're all counting on you. That's a line from the movie Airplane. Well, listen carefully. I think all of us might just hear the Father above all the noise and the fear and the mayhem and uncertainty around us, saying to all of us, I just want you to know. And may all of us, you and I, his sons, and all who are praying for him and trying to be saints in your own homes, may all of us sigh and say, yes, yes, I know, we're all counting on you. The Father is speaking to us today. If we have ears to hear, he started something, or rather, he transplanted and nurtured something that St. Philip started and that Newman continued, and he has brought it and us to where we are today. Now he is saying to us, St. Philip's sons, I just want you to know that we, all the saints, and me, the Father, the least of all the saints, we're all counting on you. Jonathan Robinson, faithful son of St. Philip, father and founder of the Toronto Oratory, you can count on us to pray for you, to remember you, and try, like you, to imitate St. Philip, to persevere to the end, to rise after our falls, never to lose hope, to be saints in our own homes, this home that is the Oratory, and the homes of all those whom you administered to in their homes. Eternal rest grant unto him, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon him. May his soul and the souls of all the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you.
non intret in judicium cum servo tuo, Domine, quia nullus apud te justificabitur homo, nisi per te omnium peccatorum ei tribulatu remissio. Non ergo eum praesimus tua judicialis, sententia plena, quem tibi vera supplicatio fidei Christiane commenta, sed gratia tua illi sicurei, periatur valere judicium crucium, quidum vivere sensibili, et signaculo sancte civitate, divis regnas in saecula saeculorum. Amen.
Jesus.
Et ne nos inducas in tentationem,
sed libera nos a malo,
a porta in feri, requiescat in pace.
Amen.
Domine exaudi rationem meam,
et maurem salve meam.
Dominus vobiscum, oremus, Deus tui proprium est miserere sempre partere, te subices exoramus pro anima famili tui Jonathan sacerdotius, quam hodie de hoc saeculo migrare insisti, ut non tradas eam in manus inimici, neque obliviscaris infinem, sed iubias erma sanctis angelis susciti, ed ad patriam paradisi perduci, ut quia in te speravit et credidit, non penas in Christus tineat, sed gaudia eterna possidiat, per Christum Dominum nostrum.
Amen.